Well, good morning and welcome to church. Welcome to our morning service. If you're watching this as one of the members of Trinity or Cooper's Edge Baptist Church, and if you're watching this alone, then can I urge and encourage you, next week, see if you can watch this service with another household. Let me appeal especially to those of you who, like ourselves, are privileged enough to be able to watch these services on a big TV screen at home. Why not welcome another household in so that you can watch that together? Think especially of those who are maybe having to watch this service on a laptop, on a tablet, or even on a smartphone. How much better it would be to watch it as two family groups, as two household units together, to be able to watch on the big screen. Now, there's no evening service tonight, so why not make the opportunity to give someone a phone call, go round and say hello, or tune into one of the other services that other churches across the country will be streaming. Last week, we concluded our series that we were looking at in Philippians and also our series in 1 Peter. And so it's my joy and privilege this morning to bring in something new. And this is a series that we've called Time to Turn. And it's based upon the lives and ministries of the Old Testament prophets Elijah and Elisha. And so this morning we're going to have something of an introduction to their ministries. So in preparation for that, we're going to have two readings, and we're going to have the first one now. And Becky is going to read to us from Deuteronomy chapter 17. After that, we're going to sing our first song together. And I asked Becky if she would choose it, and she's chosen Above the Voices of the World. So let's hear God's word and let's sing together.
The reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 14 to 20. When you come to the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you possess it and dwell in it, and then say, I will set a king over me like all the nations that are around me. You may indeed set a king over you, whom the Lord your God will choose. One from among your brothers you shall set as king over you. You may not put a foreigner over you, who is not your brother. Only he must not acquire many horses for himself, or cause the people to return to Egypt in order to acquire many horses, since the Lord has said to you, you shall never return that way again, and he shall not acquire many wives for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he acquire for himself excessive silver and gold. And when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself in a book a copy of this law, approved by the Levitical priests. And it shall be with him, and he shall read in it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God by keeping all the words of this law and these statutes, and doing them, that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers, and that he may not turn aside from the commandment, either to the right hand or to the left, so that he may continue long in his kingdom, he and his children in Israel.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Our Father, let me become what you shall choose to make me, freed from the guilt and burden of my sins. Jesus is mine, who never shall forsake me, and in his love, my newborn life begins. Our Father, thank you for these words that we have just sung. Thank you for this reminder that through the love of Jesus, newborn life begins. And we do thank you for that new life in Jesus, that we are rescued, we're delivered out of death, we're delivered out of the guilt and shame of our sin, we're forgiven, we are cleansed, we're adopted, we're reconciled, we're restored. Father, thank you that through the good news about Jesus, we can know peace and hope and joy. So help us to be filled with these things. Help our believing. Help us to believe, and that we might know these things in the midst of every circumstance. We know that we face all manner of difficulty at the moment, and I know that those listening to this message, there'll be some in particular facing all kinds of stress. Perhaps difficult relationships at home. Perhaps problems with work or unemployment. Perhaps issues of mental health and struggles. Father, please, would you meet with us and help us? Help your children everywhere to know the joy of following Jesus, to know the peace that comes from believing in him, to know the hope that is secured by the knowledge of his return. Father in heaven, I thank you for the preaching series that we've had over the last few months whilst we've been meeting in lockdown. Thank you for those wonderful, precious letters of Philippians and 1 Peter. And Father, I pray that we would not be unmoved and unchanged by those. May we not forget the lessons of those letters. Help us to internalise what we have learned. Help us to keep going back to those letters and to drink afresh of the wonderful truth that is there. So Father, help us in terms of knowing our identity, who we are. To remember that we are in Christ and Christ is in us, that we are the people of God, that we are a new creation born again to a living hope. May that be the dominant identity marker in our lives. Help us as we think about our calling, who we are to be those who are seeking the interests of others, to be those who are holy as you are holy. Help us as we think about our ministry as a church, as Christians, to each other and to the wider world. Help us as churches to be places of unity, of humility. May we be truly joined to each other as living stones, building up a temple for God. And help us as our witness to the world around us. May we be those who truly are able to rejoice in the Lord always, who truly are able to learn the secret of being content. May we be those who long for the return of the Lord, who look to his coming, and in whatever situation we find ourselves, in our homes, in our work, help us to see each day as worship to the living God, displaying contentment and trust in you. Above all, dear Father, what we want most of all from these preaching series we've had is for a closer walk with Jesus, is a deeper love and a deeper knowledge of your love for us. Help us to love you more. Help us to love each other more. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that it is powerful. Thank you that it challenges us, it rebukes us, and it corrects us, but it encourages us, it builds us up, it does us good, and may it continue to do that. May you continue to speak and to help us as churches and as your people. May you continue to speak to those listening who are not yet your people, that they would hear your voice and turn to you. And so, Father, I want to commit to you our new series as we begin today, looking at the lives of Elijah and Elisha. Give us great wisdom as we think about these Old Testament accounts, these narratives. May they come alive within us. Help us to understand them. Help us to see how they point us to our need of you, our need of the Lord Jesus Christ. May we be changed, may we be challenged and transformed. So, Father, thank you for this opportunity we have to gather again. I pray that you would meet with us. Please encourage us. Please help us. Please give us energy and enthusiasm and motivation in the midst of times that are so trying, so difficult. Please build us up. Please help us and do us good. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing once more the song Jesus is Lord, and then I invite you to go and join me in our garden, and I'm going to speak to the children. Well, good morning, children, and welcome to our garden. Now, I'm just here sitting in the garden having a look at an interesting book, which is our wedding photos. Wow, we were so young back then. It seems like such a long time ago. Well, let me share with you a couple of photos in particular. Here's this one. That's an interesting photo, isn't it? It looks like we're speaking to each other. That's the point in the service, when we're giving vows to each other. We're making solemn promises. Promises of what we will do from this point onward. Oh, and here's another one. That might look like a strange photo. We're both writing things in a book. That's when we're signing the register, when we are legally declaring that we will be husband and wife. You see, we all know, don't we, that marriage isn't just like any old friendship. Marriage is binding. On your wedding day, you declare that you will love each other and keep to each other. And so you give rings, and you sign the register to show that you now are part of a new, binding relationship. Now, why do I say that? Why talk about our wedding day? It's for this reason. We're starting a new series today, looking at the books of 1 and 2 Kings and thinking about the lives of the prophets Elijah and Elisha. And in order to understand the significance of those books, we need to understand that God is in a very special relationship with Israel called a covenant. And a covenant is a bit hard to get your head around, but basically it's a lot like a marriage. Two people enter into this special covenant relationship, they make promises, and then if they're going to enjoy the relationship, they need to keep the promises. So God makes promises to Israel,
God calls Israel to obey the terms of the covenant, and as long as Israel obeys, then there's great blessing. But when Israel turns away and worships other gods, then terrible things happen. And it's within that context that we understand the lives and ministries of Elijah and Elisha. Now, not wishing to spoil the story, but Israel doesn't do very well. They disobey God. They go away from him. They betray him. And so God promises that one day he'll make a new covenant, a covenant that's different because he's going to write his law on the hearts of his people. And all of them will know the Lord. And that new covenant is something you and I can be part of. If we trust in Jesus, if we put our faith in him, if we ask him to forgive us, and if we turn to him, then you know what? God enters a covenant relationship with us. We become his people. He becomes our God. And he'll never leave us, and he'll never forsake us. Think of that. The great God of the universe enters something like a marriage relationship with you and me. And it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter where you've come from or what you've done. If you truly believe in Jesus, then you can become part of God's covenant people. So next time that you look at some wedding photos, think about covenant. Think about God and his people through Jesus. Okay, John, back to you.
Well, before we come to our second reading this morning from God's word, let's sing of that word. Let's sing together, God has spoken by his prophets. Spoken his unchanging word. Let's sing this together. Now, in the past few months, a number of aspects of church life have had to be put on hold. Nonetheless, the church has remained, the church still operates, still functions, still grows. And it's been our pleasure and joy at Cooper's Edge Baptist Church to welcome Aaron and Jude Spiller as members into the congregation in a special church meeting that we had a couple of months ago. Well, Aaron is now going to read to us our second reading this morning from 1 Kings chapter 16. When I asked him to do a reading, he expressed his preference that it would be short and not filled with lots of difficult names. Short it is, only six verses, but it has something like 15 different Hebrew names. So sorry, Aaron, for putting you through your paces, but thanks for reading.
Good morning. My name is Aaron Spiller. I'm married to Jude, who's doing the recording this morning. Hello. John has asked us to do the reading this morning. We've been members of Cooper's Edge since just before the lockdown. So the reading this morning is from 1 Kings 16, verses 29-34. So just wait a moment for you to find that. So it's titled, Ahab Reigns in Israel. So starting at verse 29. In the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab, the son of Omri, began to reign over Israel. And Ahab, the son of Omri, reigned over Israel in Samaria for 22 years. And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord, more than all who were before him. And as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, he took for his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. He erected an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he built in Samaria. And Ahab made an Asherah. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. In his days, Hiel of Bethel built Jericho. He laid its foundations at the cost of Abiram, his firstborn, and set up its gates at the cost of his youngest son, Segub, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Joshua, the son of Nun. And that's today's reading.
Well, as we come to God's word, let's pray and ask him to help us. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to begin this new series this morning, and I pray that you would help us to know your truth, help us to understand your word, help us to take the effort to dig deep, to understand what you have written and the significance of it and how it should impact us today. Please speak to us and do us good. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever been in a situation in which you felt completely like a fish out of water? So uncomfortable, so out of your comfort zone. Maybe it was going to a foreign country or being surrounded by people that spoke another language, had different customs. Maybe that was your experience coming to this country. Perhaps you've come here from a different country and you've got to get used to our funny British ways and British sense of humour and all our Britishness, so much of which doesn't really make a great deal of sense. I mean, for me, few things make me feel at home more than a nice mug of coffee and a large piece of carrot cake. But there have been plenty of times in my life when I felt completely out of home. And a case in point would be when I was younger and I had a Jewish friend and I had the privilege of being invited to attend his bar mitzvah. Now, if you've never been to one of those, that's a real honour to be invited to one. So my dad and I went along to the synagogue. It's the first time I'd ever been to one. And without really knowing what we were doing, we marched promptly straight into the ladies' section. We were very quickly ushered out of there and pointed towards the men's section. And so rather sheepishly, we went to the back of the men's section where my dad lifted his head up like this. And all of a sudden, his skullcap fell backwards back into the ladies' section. Needless to say, we felt a little bit rather like fish out of water. Ooh, it's just sort of cringeworthy. It makes you feel really uncomfortable. Friends, I think that's how a lot of Christians feel when they go into the Old Testament. Sort of dip their feet into the water, maybe with a few psalms, maybe a few of the big stories like the Exodus or David and Goliath or Jonah and the fish. But there's just so much of it that's just a little bit too weird, a little bit too out of our comfort zone. It's like another country there. Everything's done differently. It's like another language. The customs and the culture are so foreign and alien to where we are today. Could that be where you are? Could it be that when you open the pages of the Old Testament, you're really not sure what you're meant to be doing? Is it just to look for some examples? This guy was good, so I want to be like them. Or this person, well, they were pretty awful, so I better steer clear of that. Is that all there is to it? Well, with that in mind, it is my real privilege and joy to be introducing us to this new series this morning, looking at Elijah and Elisha, this series that we've called Time to Turn. Now, the narratives of Elijah and Elisha are found within the books of 1st and 2nd Kings. No doubt, if you've been a Christian for any length of time, you're familiar with a number of the stories. You surely know about Elijah on the top of Mount Carmel with the prophets of Baal. You'd know about Elisha and healing the Syrian general Naaman of his leprosy. But do you know what they really mean? I mean, what impact do those stories have on you today? And then what are you going to do with the murder of Naboth just to get his vineyard? Or with fire being called down from heaven upon some groups of soldiers? Or a poisonous stew that's miraculously cured? Or two she-bears coming out of the woods and mauling a pack of delinquents to death? 2 Timothy 3:16 tells us, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable. All of it is breathed out, divinely given. All of it is profitable. All of it is useful. And that certainly includes 1st and 2nd Kings. So we've spent a fair amount of time over the last few months in the New Testament books of Philippians and 1st Peter. Now it's time for the Old Testament. Now, my plan for today is to introduce us to the world of Elijah and Elisha. What I hope to do is to explain some of the important emphases and themes that need to be held in mind when we study these in order to understand them. So this, I hope, will be something like a foundation that you put in first and that we can then build on as the weeks go on. And as to help us with that, I've put together a handout. Now, the handout basically condenses all that I'm saying this morning, but it also lists all of the Bible verses that I will be quoting to or referring to. So if you are expecting to take notes furiously, you don't have to. You can find everything on the handout. The handout will be linked onto the YouTube page, hopefully, and on our website. If you can't find it, then just flick me an email and I can email it to you. So a couple of notes just to begin with before we get started. 1 and 2 Kings is one book. It's split into two, but that only happened a couple of hundred years before Jesus was born, when the Bible was translated from Hebrew into Greek. And because of issues to do with the size of scrolls, it was much easier to put it into two than into one big one. But it is all one book, like Samuel, like Chronicles. It's just one book in Hebrew. And you may think, well, it's quite a long book. If you've ever tried reading through it, certainly there are 47 chapters. But it's 47 chapters that cover 400 years of history. Just imagine condensing 400 years of British history into 47 chapters. So that tells us something about it. That tells us that the author has been very, very selective. He's been ruthless in terms of what he's kept and what he hasn't. So nothing in these volumes is there by mistake. And if anything's there that's repeated, then it's like there's a neon sign pointing at it. This is really, really important. So in these 47 chapters, we'll find a lot of attentions given to Elijah and Elisha. About 40% of the book covers the period in which Elijah and Elisha were active and ministering in the northern kingdom of Israel. So what I want us to do today is to consider four big ideas, four words that will help us understand the world of these men. We'll look at four words, and with each one I'll give a brief bridge to today so that we might begin to think about how this speaks to us within our own situation. So here's the first word. And as is often the case when I preach, the first word is generally the most important one. We'll spend longer here than in the others because this is so important. The word that I mentioned in my children's talk, covenant. Underlying everything that happens in the books of Kings is the idea that there is a covenant relationship between God and Israel. That's so important. If you forget everything else today, remember, God and the nation of Israel are in a covenant relationship. Now, covenants were very common in the ancient Near East, in the world of the Old Testament. They are less common today, so we need to go back to try and understand what it's all about. A covenant is a binding relationship between two parties. It's similar then to a contract in that there are terms that need to be held. There are promises made and promises that must be kept. But there are also similarities with a friendship because it's far warmer, far more personal, far more intimate than just a contract is. It's more personal than a contract, but it's more binding than a casual friendship. And at the heart of God's covenant with Israel is this declaration, which is repeated in many times in the Bible: you will be my people, I will be your God. You will be mine, I will be yours. That's the promise God makes to Israel. So it's a very special relationship, a relationship that God doesn't enter into with any other nation, just with Israel. Now, happily, the Bible uses a picture to help us understand covenant, which we get today because it's still a common covenant, and that is marriage. So that's why I brought it up in the children's talk. And I'll make lots of references to marriage today because that is how the Bible illustrates the covenant between God and his people. So marriage isn't just a casual friendship. Marriage is something that's binding, it's lifelong, it's lasting commitment. On the 9th of April 2011, I stood up amongst my church, my family, and in the sight of God, and said, I, John Cameron Kerr, take you, Lisa Claire Parker, to be my lawful wedded wife. I take you to be mine. In other words, you will be mine and I will be yours. Hence the echo of the language of God and his people. And in order to enjoy that marriage covenant, that marriage relationship, I and Lisa, we must keep to the terms of the covenant, keep to the vows that we made. And so it is with God and his people. If they will obey the covenant, if they will be faithful, if they will be loyal to God, then there will be great blessing. So then, what does God's covenant with Israel look like? Well, as the Bible story unfolds, we get more detail being added as time goes on. So let's look at this by focusing on three figures to whom God speaks and declares his covenant. The first one is where Israel begins, the call of Abraham. Genesis 12, verse 2, God promises Abraham, I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. In Genesis 15, verse 5, look toward heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them. So shall your offspring be. I am the Lord who brought you out from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. Then Genesis 17, verses 4 and following. My covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. So God calls Abraham and gives to him these promises. God binds himself to Abraham by promising certain things, saying these will be the case. And in broad terms, the three things that God promises are land, specifically the land of Canaan, offspring, a people, and blessing. Land, offspring, blessing. It's a helpful way of remembering the Abrahamic covenant. And how is Abraham to respond? Well, he and all his family are called to respond with the covenant seal. That means a mark that they belong to the covenant, which is circumcision. But God isn't interested just in a ritual. Rather, that is a sign of wholehearted allegiance and loyalty to him. But to see more of that, we come to our next figure, Moses. After God has brought Israel out of the land of Egypt and they're at Mount Sinai, God declares to Moses, now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. So again, God is making promises to Israel and holding Israel accountable to the terms of this special relationship. And we'll see those terms in much more detail over the next few books of the Old Testament, and especially in the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy is something like the wedding vows, if you want to put it like that, of Israel and God and their relationship together. So think back to the reading that we had first, that Becky read to us from Deuteronomy 17. Those were the terms that the king of Israel needed to follow in order to enjoy the blessings of the covenant. Come to the end of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and you have a lengthy chapter that is devoted to the implications of Israel's treatment of the covenant. Obedience will bring great blessing. Disobedience will bring terrible cursing. And it's all linked in with the promises to Abraham, you know, land and offspring. If there's obedience, then the land will be fruitful and fertile, and they will have many children, and they will be blessed in terms of their relationships with the other nations. It will be clear that they as a people group are blessed by the Lord. But if they go against the covenant, the land will become harmful. It will be a place of famine. It will be a place of poisonous stews and mauling she-bears, okay, just to prepare you for what's coming in the tales of Elijah and Elisha. Moreover, there'll be problems amongst the people. The foreign nations will come and suppress. Not only that, but God will start to bless the foreigners, like Syria and the Naaman. Again, introducing the ideas of what's going to come over the coming weeks. Then a third figure is David. So God promised Abraham that kings would come from him. God spoke to Moses and gave him in Deuteronomy 17 instruction for kings. When we come to David, God gives a very special promise to him. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, God promises David, "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Your throne shall be established forever." So as part of this covenant relationship, God has promised that there'll be a king from the line of David who will reign over his people forever. And so at this point, then, the covenant, we see something of an individual nature, like the king representing the many, the king as an individual representing the corporate body. And as we will see in the stories of Elijah and Elisha, generally, as goes the king, so go the people. The king goes bad, the people follow. So there we go. Abraham, Moses, David, a brief introduction to covenants within Israel. But you cannot understand Israel without having a grasp of covenant. Now, before we move on, let's just pause to think about some of the significance of that for a moment. Two words to think about: privilege and uniqueness. First of all, privilege. This is a stunning concept. God enters at his own bidding a binding relationship with people. The God who invented thunder and neutron stars, who dwells in unapproachable light, who exists outside of time, who is completely without limit save by his own nature, that God enters into a binding relationship with dust, and rebellious dust at that. If you put your trust in Jesus, then you become part of the new covenant people of God. So it's like we're married to God. And in fact, the Bible does use that language. It calls Jesus the bridegroom and the church the bride. God has bound himself by his own word, by his own promises to his people. He that the limitless God, the infinite God, is bound by his own promise to us. He is, in a sense, under the obligation of his word, purely because of his own choice. Isn't that just extraordinary? Isn't that just amazing? What delight or joy on this earth could compare with knowing that, in knowing that you could be part of that relationship, in knowing that I can be in this marriage-like relationship with a loving father, with my loving God, who will never leave me, that will never divorce me, will never get rid of me. Isn't that extraordinary? Privileged, but also unique. Israel is the only nation that God has entered into such a covenant with. Okay, you cannot draw simplistic parallels between the UK and any modern nation. I can't describe the UK, Israel and any modern nation. You can't describe the UK like Israel. There is, however, continuity between the church and Israel. So we are the covenant people of God today. Galatians 3 specifically calls us sons of Abraham. But there's also discontinuity because it's a different covenant. The covenants that bound Israel are not the same as the covenants, the new covenant that we're in. And we need to bear that in mind. So covenant, then, that's our first word, and that refers to the kind of relationship that exists between Israel and God. Here's our second word, idolatry. Idolatry refers to the single greatest threat to that covenant relationship. An idol is essentially anything that we esteem higher than or equal to God, anything that we live for, that drives us, what we obey in place of or alongside even the Lord Jesus Christ. False worship, worship of other gods. And it's a major problem in the books of Kings. It all starts happily enough. Solomon becomes king, you know, Solomon the wise. But man, does he fall. And he's led astray and his heart is turned away to other gods. And so after him, his son comes along and the kingdom split. And in the south, David's line, Judah, just retains two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, in the southern kingdom of Judah, ruled by David's sons. The northern kingdom is 10 tribes. And the first king of the northern kingdom is called Jeroboam. And he is cunning. He's sneaky. He knows that the law of Moses demands that people go to Jerusalem throughout the year for temple worship. And he knows that if the people do that, it might lead them back to David's line. And he doesn't want that. It could lead to the kingdoms being reunited. And so what does he do? He creates an alternative worship system. He creates his own kind of temple system, if you will, without the temple, his own sacrificial system, his own priesthood. Note, he's not saying to people, worship a different God. He's saying, worship the same God, but in a different way. But God alone dictates the means by which he may be worshipped. So whilst this might look very clever and crafty, it's extremely dangerous compromise. And Jeroboam becomes the pioneer of all Israelite idolatry. Now, after Jeroboam, there's a lot of kings in fairly quick succession with a couple of exceptions. There's a lot of violence. There are plots and conspiracies and assassinations. Kings get killed, replaced with other kings who quickly after get killed and replaced with other kings, until eventually the commander of the army, whose name is Omri, becomes the king in the north. He doesn't reign for a particularly long time. He dies and he is replaced by his son. And let me introduce you to him, King Ahab. Now, if you do have your Bible open at 1 Kings 16, it'd be good to look at it now, because now we're introduced to King Ahab. Now, remember what I said, the writer of these books has been very selective. So if he ever repeats something, then just prick your ears up at that point. Look at 1 Kings 16, verse 30. Ahab did evil more than all who were before him. Now look at verse 33. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. Why? What was so bad about Ahab? Verse 31, he took for his wife Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. He erected an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he built in Samaria. And Ahab made an Asherah. Baal and Asherah were the sort of chief god and goddess consort couple of the Canaanites. And what has Ahab done? He's institutionalized their worship. Note again, he's not saying stop worshipping Yahweh. He's saying add the worship of these guys. And we'll see in a couple of weeks' time when Elijah confronts the prophets of Baal. He says to them, stop floating around between two opinions. Choose who you're going to worship. Is it going to be God? Is it going to be Baal? Now, such idolatry, the Bible speaks of in the language of spiritual adultery. Again, this is borrowing from the language of marriage. If the covenant is like a marriage between God and his people, then idolatry is like a man going and sleeping with a woman that's not his wife. Now, why was it such a temptation? Why did Israel go this way? Well, in Canaanite worship, as I said, you've got Baal and Asherah. And what do they promise? A good harvest and good fertility. And we need to understand the allure of such things, the strength of such things. It's, I think, especially the first one, it's very easy for us to be blasé about the fact that we can always go to Tesco or Sainsbury's or whatever and get our food shopping. But imagine if you depended on the rains coming at the right time. You see, this Israel wasn't like Egypt. Egypt had the Nile, which meant they could do irrigation. They were fairly safe in terms of always being able to get enough food. But that wasn't the case in ancient Canaan. They were hugely dependent on the right weather. And the fear of a crop failure could be devastating. We may not be able to relate to that first one, but I know that people within our churches can relate to the second issue. Those who have lost children, those who've had miscarriages, those who have been unable to conceive or have struggled to do so. There is an anguish associated with that. Imagine someone comes along and says, I can cure all of that. Just offer sacrifices to this God. You don't have to stop worshipping Yahweh. Just offer some sacrifices to Baal and Asherah alongside. What's the big deal? And so we'll see again in a couple of weeks' time when we get to Elijah on Mount Carmel. It's all about who is going to bring the rain. Will Baal bring the rain or will Yahweh bring the rain? So why not hedge your bets, Israel? Why not worship them all? Just add some more gods into the worship. Now, God responds to this with heavy judgment. Why is this such a big deal? Why does God get so upset? Well, two primary reasons. Firstly, because idolatry robs God of what's rightfully his and his alone. Worship is only due to God. Just try to imagine how offensive it is. God creates man out of nothing. He fashions us from the dust and gives us life. And then man goes and forms a god of his own making and worships that. He worships his own invention, disregards his maker. And the second thing is because idolatry destroys people. Idolatry leads to death and devastation. At the end of Deuteronomy, in chapter 30, Moses gives this really passionate plea to the people of Israel to obey the covenant. How does he summarize it? Therefore, choose life. To love and obey and trust God means choosing life. To disregard and disobey and distrust God means choosing death. Because whatever you worship drives your lifestyle. And that was certainly true in ancient Israel. They started worshipping false gods, and the land soon became filled with injustice and inequality, and the poor were oppressed, and widows and orphans were neglected and abandoned. Now, again, this idea of idolatry has much to say to us today, but especially this, note, mixed worship. That's far more subtle. It's unlikely to be too many voices in the church telling us we shouldn't worship Jesus, but there might be those who say we should mix Jesus with a few other bits too. And we can think about that more in the weeks to follow. So God enters a covenant with Israel. The people respond with idolatry, with covenant disloyalty. What happens next? Prophecy. It's our third word. God responds with the prophets. Men like Elijah and Elisha, and some women as well. Now, what are the prophets? They were CEOs, covenant enforcement officers. They were there to call the people back to the covenant, back to covenant loyalty, back to covenant faithfulness to God. Hence, again, why we've called this series Time to Turn, because that's the big message of the prophets. Turn, come back, repent, come back to God. God calls you to turn back. In particular, they were sent to the king. The king was not above the law. The king was called to submit to the law of God. And so the prophets had the authority on behalf of God to rebuke and challenge the king. Again, let's use this marriage analogy because the Bible uses it so much. It's like a man's gone out for the evening. He's told his wife and family that he's got a work meal to go to, but instead he's meeting another woman for dinner and there's flirtation and there's the thought of what might happen next time. And as he's smugly walking back to his car afterwards, someone comes up to him and confronts him and says to him straight there and then, you need to repent. You need to go back to your wife, own up all you've done, accept whatever consequences, and never see this other woman again. That's the idea, that the prophets are saying, you have been disloyal and unfaithful. This needs to stop. Go back to God. So it's a hard-hitting, no-nonsense, authoritative, however you pronounce that word, command that comes from the prophets. They are speaking on God's behalf. But, especially in the case of Elijah and Elisha, they're not only speaking on God's behalf, they also act. They don't only call the people back to the covenant, but they also become the means by which God enacts, implements the blessings and the curses of the covenant. Begin to see that from next week. Ahab, here he is. He's held up as this new king who has brought in Baal worship. And so Elijah goes to him and says, for the next months and years, it won't rain until I say so. What's that all about? That's Elijah enacting the covenant curses. That's Elijah coming and representing God in not only what he says, but in what he does. Now note, the prophets don't just bring in judgment, they do bring grace as well. So we'll see both Elijah and Elisha performing miracles that restore covenant wholeness to those who are faithful. And typically it is the marginalized. We'll see the sick healed and the dead raised and the poor lifted up. So over the coming weeks, we'll have this special emphasis looking at Elijah and Elisha. They are highlighted for us. There's more about them than any other prophets in 1st and 2nd Kings. And so we'll be thinking a bit more about their ministry as God's covenant enforcement officers. But also see them as humans, as men with struggles. Now, Elijah struggles greatly with doubt, with fear, with despair. This was a really tough calling. They have to respond to Jezebel, who's this horrific queen who's set to kill God's people, God's prophets. Then they have to deal with hundreds of false prophets who are spreading a wrong message, who are saying peace, peace, when there is no peace. But God sends them as an expression of his grace. He wants to call his wayward people back to him. And so as we think about this for today, this reminds us of an uncomfortable but necessary truth of the absolute authority of the Word of God. In our lives, we are not the authority. Our wisdom, our feelings, our thoughts is not the highest level. We must be below the Word of God. And sometimes the Word of God comes to us with encouragement to build us up. And sometimes the Word of God comes to rebuke us and say, you need to stop that and turn back now. I wonder which of those could be more likely for you today. Maybe God's word is telling you, turn. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 2 says this, that God is saying, this is the one I will look to. This is the one I will esteem. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Do you tremble when God speaks? God enters a covenant with Israel. They are disloyal in idolatry. God sends the prophets to warn them, but Israel will not listen to the prophets. And so there is one inevitable conclusion, our fourth word, exile. Exile, that's where everything is headed in 1st and 2nd Kings. That's not spoiling the end. That's where it's inevitably going. Exile is the ultimate covenant curse. Again, Deuteronomy 28, verses 64 and following tells us, the Lord will scatter you among all peoples, from one end of the earth to the other. And among these nations you shall find no respite, and there shall be no resting place for the sole of your foot. and the Lord will bring you back in ships to Egypt. If Israel persists in ignoring the prophets, then the nation will be removed from the land of promise. That's the threat. That's the ultimate warning. And really, that's why these books are written, to explain why that happened, to explain why the exile took place. Okay, the northern kingdom in 722 BC, taken to exile in Assyria. The southern kingdom, Judah, lasted a bit longer, but eventually went the same way. 605 BC, taken to Babylon. And we need to understand, those who were reading 1st and 2nd Kings shortly after the exile finished, we need to understand how big the exile was. I mean, think of, what was it that made Israel Israel? What did they have that was so special? Well, they had the land promised to Abraham. They had the temple that was instituted, the sacrificial system under Moses. And they had the king promised to David. The Abrahamic land, the Mosaic sacrifice, and the Davidic king. And what has happened? They're out the land, the temple's destroyed, and the king is no longer in charge. These main things, these huge promises God had made, it's like he's taken them away. And so it's described in terms of a reversal of the Exodus. Hence those words from Deuteronomy 28, you shall go back in ships to Egypt. They're back to Egypt, into the land, out of the land. So as we read through these accounts and see things go from bad to worse, know that it's heading towards an inevitable conclusion. The exile is coming. And so that's one reason for writing these books. It's to warn future generations. To warn them that God's patience has a limit. To warn them that false worship is serious. To warn them that God takes seriously his covenant relationship, and to warn them that God's word is enduring. And we get a little picture of that in that strange last verse in 1 Kings 16. Again, if you've got your Bible open there, look at Hiel of Bethel building Jericho. Why is that mentioned? Because God had spoken through Joshua, don't rebuild Jericho. It was a wicked city. Do not rebuild it. If you do, this is what will happen. And so God's word is fulfilled. And there's warning. You see, all humanity by nature is in exile. All of us by nature are idol worshippers. All of us by nature are covenant breakers. And the Bible would warn us. It is appointed for men and women to die once and then the judgment. And when we stand before God, if he sees us in our sin, then the exile becomes permanent, banished from the goodness and grace of God for eternity. Is that your future? Is that what you would face? Is there a way out of this? Is there a way by which we can heed the warnings and not end up in this terrible exile? Yes, because there's one who's been exiled for us. When Jesus was taken out of the city and lifted up between heaven and earth on that cross, he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because he knew the exile of God himself. It was as if he had been cast off in place of us. Now, he is the only one who could, and he is the only one who has done that for you. That's why the Christian faith says there's no other way. It's Jesus or nothing. No one else has been exiled from God on your behalf. Now, you can ignore him, you can scoff at him, you can laugh at him, you can hate him, but one day you will face Jesus either as your Lord and Saviour or your Lord and Judge. So let me ask you this morning, these words of warning from the Bible, are you ready to face him? Have you received the Lord Jesus Christ? The books of Kings remind us the warning. God's word is true. The things he has promised, he will fulfill. Covenant, idolatry, prophecy, exile. Four key words, four key concepts to have some grasp of as we enter this unfamiliar territory of 1st and 2nd Kings. May God use this series to give us a greater honour for his word, a greater sense of his holiness, and a greater desire to walk with him. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for your word. Thank you for how you've revealed yourself progressively over time in the pages of Scripture. Thank you for the amazing truth that you've declared to us. Thank you for these wonderful things we thought about this morning. Thank you for the amazing thought that you would enter into a covenant through us, that if we've trusted in Jesus, we're part of your new covenant people, and it's like you're married to us. That is just the most amazing thought. So help us, Father, to think on that and be encouraged by that, but help us also to see the warnings here, the subtleties of idolatry, and the warnings that your word gives, and the reality of exile. And one day, for those who reject Jesus, there is a permanent exile. Oh, Father, I pray for all who listen this morning that none of us would harden our hearts to Jesus, but all of us would turn to him and trust in him. So please help us over the coming weeks and months as we look to this series, as we look to these individuals and to your word. Please help us and feed us and fill us and mature us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our closing song is all about the promise of God's word from the breaking of the dawn. Let's sing this together. close with words from the prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that for which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy, and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Well, may God lead you forth in peace, and may you indeed go out in joy. Amen.